Well, we are on the road again. It is that's about 19 hours and 50 minutes into the day of Friday, July 15th, 2016. And it's time for another peripatetics because we are going food shopping again. It's later in the evening. It's cooler out, so I don't need the hat. The hat protects you if you have to walk between anywhere between 11 o'clock in the morning till about 6 or 7 in the evening when you have a very harsh sun beating down on your head to protect the vital organ called the brain. You need a hat that provides protection from the sun, particularly if you have black hair like I do, or even people who are blonde. A lot of times there isn't the melatonin in the skin to protect the scalp from the rays of the sun. So now I'm holding the camera like this because if I held it the other way, there'd be an issue with the setting sun. This is what I was concerned about, that the sun is now setting. It is behind me. And if I held the camera the wrong way, the sun will be behind me, and it'll be in the camera, and it'll affect the brightness and how you, in terms of how you see myself. So I am trying to be conscious of the cinema photography, you know, the layout, the setup of how I'm placed in the screen. Sometimes I make mistakes, or it's not always as good as I expect it to be, or should be. That's because there's too much shaking. See, there we go again. We're behind like this. If we go help by like this, can't really see what's in the screen there. It's gonna be interesting to see if it comes out, how it comes out, because the sun is now directly behind me. It might even be in the lens itself, causing issues. Move into the shadow, move into the shades, into the shade, and this is the image we get now. So I think even though it's more tiring for the arm to have it like this to be on the left hand, I think this is the position, the best position for the camera. So we will have to adjust. Now this time, I'm not gonna vlog when I cross the street. I said that it is a little dangerous. You do have to pay attention because cars don't always see you. There is a stopping distance depending on the speed they're going and the weight of the vehicle. These all become factors in stopping time. And I said, although yes, you do indeed have the right of way as a pedestrian, you can either, in many cases, you can either have your right to do something or your life, but not both. So I'd rather live, and so in this case, the right, the battle, is walking out into traffic and expecting everybody to stop is an unreasonable position. Maybe we've got to change again. An unreasonable position, and I shouldn't expect or impose my unreasonable assumptions on others. And this is sort of the situation here, that when we get to the end of the street here, which we are now doing, it'll be time to cross, and courtesy is always the best policy. Right? Common courtesy, common sense. The non-socialist way to do things, or the individualist way of doing things. Anyways, I'll be back in the next segment. We'll begin our peripatetics. We'll have a bit of a discussion. We'll continue on in terms of the history and understanding of socialism, and a look into the socialist mind, or socialist psychology. Well, welcome back, everybody, to the next segment of Big Bang Theory or else BTS vlog. It is the second segment, and we're going to get into our peripatetics. First, our time at date stamp. It is 20 hours and 35 minutes into the day of Friday, July 15th, 2016. Yeah, I finished my food shopping, which is always a joy. Well, I just mean that sarcastically and saying it at the same time as a good thing. I'm always amazed at that when you buy prepared foods, processed foods, how much more expensive they are as compared to when you make something yourself. I think they're at least twice as expensive. So remember that if you go to mostly having food you make yourself, you're cutting your costs by 50%. That's what I've experienced. This is kind of one of the reasons why I like the Asian stores. The Asian stores keep their produce, the fresh food, because most Asians cook, at least in the area that I'm in anyways, and what I've experienced, they cook. So what happens, their food prices like this are kept low. You can't find as many processed items in the store. You have the TNT here, you have the occasional processed items, occasional processed foods, but not much. It's not like compared to a regular North American store. That's why sometimes if I want to get something like a sausage, a large sausage, that I can cut up and make sandwiches with, because sometimes it's hot, particularly in the summers, if my air condition is not working right and it gets up to 80, 90 degrees, you can't cook because the heat will add just simply, it's too hot to cook. And so this is where you sort of, you're forced into processed food, because you go get a sausage which is processed, and I can get them from another store. It's somewhat North American. It's in, again, an immigrant area, but a different type of immigrant. They have sausages, and I can get these nice large sausages for just about $10. So that's what I do, and that's why sometimes I'm going to another store to get the sausages that I want, particularly for very hot days where it's just basically going to be a sandwich and that's about it. So we're going to cross the street, and once we cross the street, we're going to get into our peripatetics discussion. I think it's, we can do that now because there's not a lot of traffic, but I'll turn it around so you can see what I'm doing. Here we go. So this is where I talk about negotiating across the street here. Two cars just went. There's two cars lined up. There's one car there. There's nothing here. I'm going to let this guy on the left go by. He didn't have his turn signals on. He's going left, though. And now it's clear and free for me to cross with no particular incident. And that was crossing the street. Now notice that I had the right of way. Right? The laws in Canada state I have the right of way. I could have not cared. That's what a lot of pedestrians do. Not cared, and then walked out into the street in front of the cars and just said my right of way, and that was the end of it. But you saw there, with a little common courtesy, I crossed the street in The amount of time it held me up can be measured in seconds. And this is something that is completely beyond the socialist mind. The socialist mind is so focused on the rights, these conceptual ideas, that they throw reality out the window and substitute it with their own sense of reality. And this can actually be shown historically. And this is where I talk about the word moron, idiots, imbeciles, feeble-minded, are actually definitions that can be looked into by reading Dostoevsky. If you don't know Dostoevsky, read his works, you can see that there. You can see it in the works of Freud. You can see it in the works of most of the history of psychology and psychiatric history. And the thing is that these are words that were created because this is where I need to make a correction. The socialists on the right, the nationalists, they're called nationalists, they're not really nationalists in the sense that we understand nationalism today. They're geneticists. They believe in genetic breeding and that the national race must be kept pure. This is the nationalism. Nationalism is about the purity of race. And they too, even though they're not, you know, stated to be so, but they're progressives. They don't have the same view of progress that a socialist on the left has, but they are nonetheless progressives. But their views are progress is made through genetics and genetic engineering. So if you look at all this stuff, the GMO, genetically modified foods, genetically modified organisms, in vitro fertilization, all these so-called biotech that alters the genetic structure of any living organism, you're looking at the progressive on the right. That's their field. They're based on something known as the chemical man. That man is nothing more than a set of chemical processes and impulses. That's what man is. Nothing more, nothing less. There is no soul. There is no higher purpose to man other than the random chemical process that goes on inside the body and inside the brain. And the brain is the physical part. It is the neurological center. So when you talk about neurology, they're talking specifically about the brain. And there is no room for the mind in that science. Ironically enough, if you go beyond the chemistry, and you have sometimes in chemistry, if you want to understand genetics, which is basically the gene is a macromolecule. And the way that the molecules are held together is through the science, anyways, if you want to get into molecular structure, is physics, particularly quantum physics. Because you're dealing with molecules, you're dealing with atoms, and atomic behavior, so you're dealing with quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics, as we know from experience from the Hubble Space Telescope, includes phenomena that are not logical. This is why quantum mechanics is not a logical science. A logical science is a deterministic science. It has facts, it has rules that are absolutely followed. A non-deterministic science like quantum mechanics is based on probability that something might happen, or the probability that something will happen. In other words, when you're looking at the position of an electron, you don't know where the electron is. This is what they even tell you when you're studying the atom as a part of quantum mechanics. They're not saying, here is where the electron is. They're saying, here is where the electron might be. They give you a cloud, they show you the cloud there. The reason why they're showing the cloud, because they don't know where the electron is. They simply say, it's somewhere within this cloud here. And that's the extent of their knowledge. This is not deterministic physics. This is probabilistic physics. And this creates a whole new problem because it opened up things like black holes in space, the extension of quantum mechanics into particle physics, into superstring theory, brings you into wormholes, parallel universes, and it brings us into things like dark matter and dark energy. In other words, we have now in the universe objects that are not seen, but yet have influence, real influence, on what we consider to be the real world. So now, even in mathematics, we sit down and look at the mathematics of things. You have two worlds now. And I'm talking about a mathematical world. You have a real world, denoted by the real number set. Then you have an I world, or an imaginary world, covered by an imaginary set of numbers. When the two planes cross, or the two spheres cross, x, y, and z, and I, x, I, y, I, z, right? You now have a complex world. And this is what we view when we view a black hole, a wormhole, or any type of interplay between a hidden universe or an unseen universe and our seen universe, the visible universe. And this brings up a problem. Because if you're studying genetics and you take the assumption that the brain is all there is, and you're going simply by what's there physically, and I've got to cross here carefully, because sometimes there are cars coming up. Then you're missing a huge chunk of physics that says, hey, wait a minute here, there is a probability that states that the mind, the spiritual aspect of the body, the psyche, the psyche, right? Psyche is Greek, is the Greek word, and psyche is the English word. They both mean the psyche, the psyche means soul. So psychologia, right? Psychology, psychologia means study of the soul. So even the physical part, the psychiatry, which is the chemical component of things. This is why the psychiatrist has to have a medical degree where a psychologist doesn't. It has primarily to do with the fact that when you're dealing with psychiatry, you're involving medicines, you're involving a chemical reaction, a neurochemical reaction, that is supposed to resolve the problems. So what happens is, there before, neurology does not consider the mind to be there. It assumes everything to be chemical. The first failure in this is when they realize that twins, although particularly the twins that are born from the same egg, even though the twins who are born from that same egg, which is basically a clone, although they have very similar traits and characteristics, are not exactly the same. That means even if you have a perfect clone, clones will not behave to their genetic prescriptions. This means there's something more than just simply the chemical prescription in the human body, in the human mind, or in the human brain. This opens the door now, again, for the human mind. The psyche, for the soul. And this opens the door once again to psychology. And so you have this battle back and forth between the psychologists and the psychiatrists. People who believe in external forces, that's a psychologist, and people who believe in only the physical, the psychiatrist, the geneticist or the eugenicist versus the environmentalist. The right, the nationalists who believe in breeding and genetics, are on that side of the fence of socialism. The people who believe in the environment, that the environment affects the human being, live on the left. And they are the communists. Both are socialists, both are progressive, and both follow their base ideals in order to achieve something new. Something better than what we have now, and the ultimate goal, the ultimate evolution, whether environmental or genetic, is the socialist utopia, the utopian ideas. And we're all taught this in school. Well, the utopian society. What is the ideal society? How do you engineer the ideal society? This is where you have social engineering coming in. This is where you have social science coming in. To engineer this socialist utopia. And what is a socialist utopia? It's the New World Order. So, I said there's a history to socialism that in many cases are denied by socialists. Socialists will deny their own history. This is the level of ignorance and the state of the socialist mind. And this will occur on both the left and the right. And you look into the history of these so-called socialist utopias, the NWO and the New World Orders, right? The Nazi regime was one. It failed. That was on the right. You had the communists in the Soviet Union. That failed spectacularly. We all saw that. And the thing is, there are numerous examples of failures on both the left and the right to achieve this whole concept of a socialist utopia. And this is something that's sort of beyond a large chunk of socialists who really have a superficial knowledge of socialism, because they reject, and here we're going to cross the street again. So there's nobody here, but I'm going to press the button anyways. This is the button you have to press in order to get the crossing signal. Okay. It's flashing a stop sign. That's for pedestrians anyways. So that way is flashing. It should change at some point in time. There's one car trying to beat the light. Here's another one trying to beat the light. This is what you have to be careful. That's why you can't simply walk out into the street. I had to make sure that this traffic was stopped on both sides. Here it's kind of unfortunate because there's no cars here. The danger here would be if a car is speeding up, not paying attention, can't stop in time for me to finish crossing and I get hit. That's that level of risk there. But that wasn't the case this time. Up the hill, here we go, a few minutes later. And cars are approaching that stoplight. So, yeah. Let's see, where are we now here? Yeah, so this was a socialist mind. We had a nice little talk about socialism again, getting more into the history of socialism. I said, you got to look at the work by Freud. You have to do a history of psychology, history of psychiatry, and then also you have to get into and do a good author study on who Dostoevsky was. Because the whole Dostoevsky topic really kind of is a doorway into knowledge that most people don't have. You can look at it superficially and say, oh, it's simply about socialism. But it's a lot more than just simply about socialism. Socialism, in terms of what you're seeing from Dostoevsky, is just simply part of the issue, part of the equation. There is much more beyond Dostoevsky, but Dostoevsky, in many cases, is the doorway. You can look at it as a window and never go beyond Dostoevsky, just simply peering in to see what's beyond, or you can open the door, step in, and go far beyond the timeline of Dostoevsky. Anyways, that's it for now. I don't know if there's going to be a on the patio tonight. Depends if it rains. The sky looks clear, but they're calling for rain. Let's see if the couch is dry enough to sit out on it tonight and do have an on the patio discussion. So anyways, that's it for now. I will see you in the next episode of Big Bang Theory. Thank you for joining me on our peripatetic walk. All right, take it easy.
I am the professor. And professor of what? Professor of physics.
Oh, say, can you see?
Speech rules here at Democratic Earth.